Today is our Seniors Day. Can you say amen? Amen. I want to speak toward that effort to some degree. Amen. 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 Let those assemble. We are blessed to have a great group of seniors here at our church. Amen. They are marvelous people who make a great contribution to what Southeast is all about. Amen. Pray for me. This morning, amen. If you will, turn your Bibles to the Gospel of Mark. I want to look at a familiar passage in a different twist. Mark 5, starting at verse 21 down to verse 24, and then once we get there, we'll move all the way to verse 35. Notice the movement of the text. Amen. Amen. Are you there? If not, say wait. Everybody is there. Amen. Mark 5, notice. Now when Jesus had crossed over again by boat to the other side, a great multitude gathered to him, and he was by the sea. And behold, one of the rulers of the synagogue came, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet. He worshiped him. Just a demonstrative posture of worship, prostrate. And begged him earnestly, saying, "My little daughter lies at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, that she may be healed, and she will live." So Jesus went with him, and a great multitude followed him, and thronged him, was all about him, brother. Verse 35. While he was still speaking to the woman with the issue of blood, some came from the rulers, from the ruler of the synagogue's house, who said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said to the ruler of the synagogue, "Listen, do not be afraid. Only believe." And he permitted no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. Then he came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue and saw tumult and those who wept and wailed loudly. When he came in, he said to them, "Why make the commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they ridiculed him. They laughed at him. But when he had put them all outside, he took the father and the mother of the child and those who were with him, and entered there, and entered where the child was laying. Can you see the scene? Then he took the child by the hand and said to her, Talitha kumai, which is translated, little girl, I say to you, arise. Immediately the girl arose and walked. Immediately the girl arose and walked, for she was 12 years of age, and they were overcome with great amazement, the parents and the disciples. But he commanded them strictly that no one should know it, and said that something should be given her to eat. He was going to confirm that she was not a ghost. She was really alive. Amen. I want to talk to my seniors about moving from fear to faith. Moving from fear to faith. This is, of course, all of us need to move from fear to faith. Can you say amen? By definition, fear is a painful emotion marked by alarm and disquieting of the spirit. Jairus would be a prime candidate for fear. Fear has many symptoms, and there are many indicated in the text. Among these are several that relate to persons as they grow older or wherever they are in life. They include dread, fright, terror, horror, panic, and such like fears. The fear of aging. Fear has a way of knocking us down. It has a way of dealing a blow to our bodies and to our minds. And if we identify and examine several specific fears in the text, fear is all too disturbing in all of our lives. One of the first fears that exists in the text is the fear of dependency. All of us want to live dependent of others' help. But here lies a young life, love that has never blossomed, a heart that has never raced around the tracks as many laps as it possibly can, eyes that have never used up all of its film footage, ears that have never finished recording all of its songs. Here she lies still, aged by that ageless wonder and that ageless enemy, death. It has aged her skin, it has made her feet tired, it has slowed her heartbeat down to nearly a stop. There is the fear of also physical dependency. All of her physical gifts are gone now. The bright and vibrant sea that she once had is gone now. She laughs no longer. She climbs and jumps no longer. She plays no longer in the front yard anymore. She has now been restricted to her bed. It is the fear of physical dependency. And although we have to realize that these situations are the exception and not the rule, because many who are chronologically mature are well able to take care of themselves. As statistics reveal, 80 to 85% of the people over 65 are in good health and able to take care of themselves. Yet we are often plagued by these fears. There is also the fear of personal safety. For he pleads with Jesus to come right now because his daughter is at door's death step. I wish I had a witness here. And we live in a world of locked doors, closed blinds, drawn drapes, safety alarms, and burglar bars trying to keep death off of our doorstep. And I hear the words of the prophet Isaiah that talks to us and tells us, all of the seniors that need to recognize that God really cares about them. He says in Isaiah, I am your God and I will take care of you until you are old and your hair is gray. I have made you and I will care for you. I will give you help and I will rescue you. That's the kind of God that we serve.
We need to rest in the words of that old hymn, as a song that we used to sing. Be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. Have I got a witness here? Then I see the fear of loneliness. Loneliness is one of the greatest and most common problems that older adults have to deal with in this world. It's a problem that goes both ways, because both sexes can become lonely when they grow older. One of the natural breaks that comes in our life is retirement, because when we retire from some of our social contacts, from the people we see every day, from the friendly faces that we know every day, and we are cut off, and sometimes loneliness looms large in our lives. There are two factors that go along with loneliness. Sometimes we feel rejection, other times we feel alienation. To conquer loneliness requires that we develop, warm and meaningful relationships wherever we go. In other words, just put a smile on your face. Say a friendly hello. Let other folk know that, they are just as important as you are. Quit having self-pity. Let the residue of self-pity run off your back. Recognize that you are a child of God, and God will take care of you. Have I got a witness here? We can conquer the loneliness that goes on in our lives, but we've got to recognize that God is always there, and God will always be watching over us. Now, if we are not careful, the loneliness that we experience may cause us to suffer from the not need syndrome. I'm no longer needed around here. Nobody really cares about me anymore. Nobody really is concerned about me anymore. Nobody is really calling me anymore. Baby, when was the last time you called somebody? When was the last time you wrote somebody? You see, you got to understand, in order to have friends, you got to show yourself friendly. That's what the book say. And if you respect the book will respect you. Have I got a witness here, children? Now listen, we need to recognize that God has something for all of us to do. As long as you are a child of God, God has a place for you in the kingdom of God. He's got something for you to do. As long as you are his child, you can proclaim the name of Jesus Christ. To ward off that syndrome of the not need syndrome, you are needed, you are wanted, and God cares about you. Then finally, there is the fear of death in this text, and this is by far the largest fear in the text that we are looking at today. At least there are two dimensions here in this text. We fear death for ourselves, and we fear death for someone we love. Is it harder to face death for ourselves, or is it harder to face death for someone we love? Losing a loved one, a spouse, or a close friend calls for a major adjustment in life on all levels. At first, it seems as if the whole bottom of our world has dropped off. All of a sudden, the person we used to do things with, the person we used to get around with, is no longer there on the scene anymore. But death is a part of God's plan, and he alone can give us the victory over death. Have I got a witness here? Dr. T.B. Matson puts it in his book, The Bible and Family Relationships. The fuller and more meaningful life is for a child of God is in the here and now. The calmer he will be able to accept death and to look forward to a meaningful life after death. When you are walking with Jesus, you understand that death can't do you no harm. When you are walking with Jesus, you understand, like Dr. John Williams says, that the Christian has the capacity to make death his once enemy, now his friend. The Christian has the capacity to see beyond the right now and to see in the hereafter. They understand that if we have hope in this world only, we are men most miserable. Someone has said death, the inevitable tomb, is not a period at the end of a sentence of life, but a conjunction connecting us to the life that is to come. I stop by to tell you today, baby, death can't do you no harm. Death is a blessing to a believer, but you've got to see it from God's point of view. Even though we think of death in the context of aging, what matters most is not how long we live or how long one lives, but how well one lives. How you living, that's what really matters. How you living while you're young? How you living in your middle age? How you living right now? There is good news and bad news in this text today. First, the bad news. Fear can paralyze the mind and also the body. A person can become so afraid that he is unable to think straight or physically react to the circumstances at hand. You got to be careful about fear. We refer to this kind of person as frozen in fear. Fear can also cause one to give up on life and living. But the good news is that where fear exists, faith has the possibility to take over. That's where you can move from fear to faith. Wherever you have fear, faith can step in and rearrange your world. And that's what the text is telling us today, that faith has a way of stepping in and rearranging the world that exists where fear is. And here we see in this text, faith stepping in. There was an inscription found in Bray, England. It read, "Fear knocks at the door. Faith answers. And there is no one there." That's how faith really operates. Fear always comes knocking at your door. But if you let faith answer, there will be no one standing there at the door. Have I got a witness here? In the words of Harry Emerson Fosdick, it is cynicalism and fear that freezes life. It is faith that thaws it out and releases it and sets us free. It is the fear that freezes Jairus and his daughter, but it is faith that thaws Jairus and his daughters out. And I contend it is faith that will thaw out your situation and release you and set you free. Say, "Pastor, how is that? Because, you know, I really want to know, how can I be released from all of the fears that I'm facing right here today?" Well, I see it here in the text. Go to verse 21, verse 22, and verse 23. First thing you see is this. Learn to worship, and God will work for your needs. Learn to worship, and God will work for your needs. Child of God, the first thing you need to realize is that worship is an initial act of faith, and worship is the final act of faith. You've got to learn to worship even in the face of your needs. You've got to learn to give God praise no matter where you are in life. And when we look at Jairus, he learns to worship, and God will work on your needs. God begins to work on his knees. The Bible says he comes and falls at the feet of Jesus. And the book says, nextly, Jesus got up right away and followed him. You do know that when you worship, God will work for you. When you worship, God will work things out for you. Too many of us come to church and we try to act cute. We try to act like we don't have to participate in the church, in the community of believers. I'll just sit here and be silent. But baby, when you worship, God knows how to go to work for your situation. Jairus is a Hebrew name that means Jehovah enlightens. Wish I had somebody. And what is usually true of a name is true of one's character. Jairus is an enlightened believer. He is a senior believer, and he is an enlightened believer and understands what he needs to do when things are tough, when he is in a tight spot. He understands that he can go to God in prayer. And seniors, you have understood that for a long time. In the first time you've been in a difficult spot, in the first time your back has been up against the wall, you need to do what you always have done. You've got to go to God in prayer and talk to the Lord about your situation. Even now, you are an enlightened believer. Some of these youngsters around here don't know what God can do, but you understand what God can do. You've seen God bring you from the back of the bus to the front of the bus. You've seen God bring you off dusty roads to paved streets. You understand what God can do. There he is. There he is. He has a spiritual foundation that says to him, whenever I'm in trouble, I can go to God in prayer. He learns to worship. He went from his problem to worship. He went from his pain to worship. He went from his daughter's side to worship God. And that's what we've got to do. We can't shrink back from our problems. We got to stretch our hands out to God. We've got to say, Father, I stretch my hand to thee. No other help I know. If you withdraw yourself from me, there's no place for me to go. These youngsters are running around everywhere else, but you ought to know where to go when you're in trouble. The strength of faith says God is always near. God is always ready to help. Some folk don't realize that, but you realize that God has set up shop right around the corner from you. All you got to do is get up and go to him, and he can work it out. You got to understand that God is able to deal with all of your problems. He's able to deal with all of your needs. But I see something else in this text. Verse 36. He gets up and he goes to find Jesus. Finds Jesus, he falls prostrate. Jesus gets up right away because he is a child of God that knows what he ought to do. He worships God and God works for him. Those who worship the Lord knows how to work for them. Stop coming to church acting all cute. Start to worship. And God knows how to work for you. Some of these children don't understand why you're shouting. They don't understand why you're crying. They don't understand why you're putting your feet to the floor and your hands together. Life is too far in front of them, but you've already lived some life, and you understand that it was God that brought you thus far. Learn to worship, and God will work for you. But the text says, in verse 36, let faith take over your fears, and God will work it out. That's the source of faith. Like Jairus, seniors will always hear two voices in their heads. But you have a choice to which one you're going to follow. Here come those out of his house and say, listen, Jairus, stop bothering Jesus. You know, listen, your daughter is dead. Stop troubling the Lord. And some folk tell these seniors today, listen, why you still going to church? Why you still on your knees? Why you still reading your Bible? Stop troubling the Lord, because you know it doesn't look like your situation is getting better. But you've got to learn to let your faith take over your fears. You know that God will work it out. He may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. You've learned to worship, and God has worked it out. But you've learned to let your faith take over your fears, and you've seen God begin to work on your affairs. Fear makes its contribution in our lives, because you can see fear in the text. They're weeping, they're wailing, they're making loud noise and all of that commotion. But faith makes its contributions also in our lives. There he is walking with Jesus, and Jesus is walking with him. But you've got to understand, when you hear bad news, you got to keep on walking with Jesus. Have I got a witness here? He's already walked to find Jesus, and while walking to find Jesus, somebody disrupts him on the way. There's a woman with an issue of blood. She touches Jesus, and Jesus stops the possession. He stops from going to Jairus' house, and his daughter is near death's door. But you don't hear Jairus say a mumbling word, because his faith is making a contribution now. He just keeps on walking with Jesus. He's trusted Jesus to go to him, and he's trusted Jesus while he's walking with him. He can trust Jesus in this final situation. Where does faith come from? Faith comes from God. It's a gift from God. It's God's ability in our lives. It's our ability, rather, to open up our lives to God and allow him to work in our lives. Faith helps us to appropriate God's power in our lives. And when we let faith go to work on our situation, it takes over everything. Listen, great preacher Charles Haddon Spurgeon says it like this: faith is an empty cup placed under heaven's flowing stream, the penniless hand held out for heavenly arms. I'm telling you, every word from Jesus' mouth is a flowing stream. Jesus looked at Jairus as soon as he got the bad news and says to him, baby, don't be afraid. Just keep on believing. That's really what the Greek text says. Just keep on believing. I don't care how bad it looks. Just keep on believing. Don't care what your friends say. Just keep on believing. Don't care how dark it gets. Just keep on believing. Because Jesus knows how to work it out. Let your faith overcome your fears, and God will work it out. Jesus says to him in the present imperative, stop being afraid. The very fact is, when he heard it, I'm sure fear arrested his heart. His only daughter, his only baby now had closed her eyes. Until that timeless one of death had never released anyone. But here it is, Jesus is standing by his side. Jesus looked at him and said, Jairus, don't worry about it. I can handle death. If you just keep on believing, I can handle any situation in your life. And I stopped by to tell you this morning, child of God, that's not a situation in your life that the Lord can't handle. Just keep on believing. Keep believing, keep believing. Keep trusting in Jesus. Jesus really tells him, now, Jairus, I want you to keep on believing. Now check out the tense of the verb. I want you to continue to believe. Have steadfast and sustained faith. Continue to believe in the presence of death. Seniors, I stop by to tell you, Jesus says, keep on believing. Don't care what you're facing. Don't care what's in your face. Keep on believing. As David said, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because thou art with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Keep on believing. At this point, Jairus had to believe his friends, or he had to believe the Lord Jesus Christ. What seniors should realize is things may not get better, but you can choose to continue to believe. That old leg may not get better, but you can choose to continue to believe. Arthritis may not get better, but you can choose to continue to believe. You may have to keep on taking your medicine, but you can choose to continue to believe. Age may keep turning your hair gray, but you can choose to continue to believe. Ben Crosby used to sing, you got to accentuate the positive and eliminate the negative. That's another way of saying that life is full of plus and minuses. We've got to deal with both pluses and our minuses. And sometimes the older you get, you got more minuses than you have plus. But you got to recognize that your faith is a major plus. And it'll outweigh all of your minuses. Have I got a witness here? One minus that can play havoc on our attitude and action is what we call negative expectations. Negative expectations can produce in us a certain anxiety. See, it was easy for Jairus to trust the Lord while his daughter was still alive. And while Jesus was walking with him. But once he got the negative news, it became much harder to trust in Jesus. Have I got a witness here? And sometimes life gets just like that, senior. Life gets much harder. Much harder to get out to bed. Much harder to put your feet on the floor. Much harder to put your clothes on. Much harder to do the normal things you used to do in life. But I stop by to tell you, you can keep on trusting Jesus when it gets much harder. Life has a way of being difficult, but faith has a way of making life easy. And I can just imagine Jairus' heart got a little bit lighter when Jesus says, keep on believing. And every now and then you got burdens that you're carrying around, but if you cast your cares on the Lord, life can get a whole lot lighter when you trust in Jesus. Listen, seniors need to recognize that they can make a major contribution to their families through their faith. You see, Jairus was about to make a major contribution to his family through his faith. You will never make a greater contribution to your family, seniors, than your faith. You see, Jairus was at the point in which his faith contributed to his children becoming back alive, or his child, rather, becoming back alive. Seniors, I stopped by to tell you today, you got to be careful how you're walking with Jesus. Because your children are connected to how you're walking with Jesus. You got to be careful how you talk about your pastor, because your children are listening to how you are talking about your pastor. You got to be careful how you get up out of your bed and come on down to the house of the Lord, even when there are problems in your life, because your children are going to be watching you coming to God's house when you got a problem in your life. You've been talking about God's your all in all. You've been talking about Jesus is your keeper. Well, then you got to act like the Lord's your keeper when things get rough in your life. You got to act like God can make a way out of no way when things get rough in your life. You got to act like God is able to hold you when you can't hold yourself. You got to get up and shout anyhow. Seniors, you making a contribution that we can't live without. It isn't the young helping the old, it's the old helping the young. It looks like that today. That the old got to help the young. We've lost our way. We don't know how to save any money anymore. We don't know how to slow down anymore. We don't know how to make the right choices anymore. It isn't the young helping the old. The old got to help the young. Look at verse 39. Let your faith interpret your situation. God is working. That's literally what the text says. That's the substance of faith. Why don't you look at it for yourself? When he came in, said to them, why make the commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping. Have I got a witness here? I don't know about you, that sounds like God is working. You got to let your faith interpret your situation. Everybody knows what the Bible says about faith in the New Testament. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. What Jesus was talking about was what is to be hoped for, and evidence by faith. He had the evidence before it came to pass, because faith is the title deed of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You can have the title deed to your house before it's ever built. I wish I had a witness. I think that just leaped over you right there. In other words, God can do something in your life before it's ever done. I wish I had somebody. That's what Jesus says. He walks in the room and says, it's done. I know y'all saying the child is dead, but I'm saying the child is alive. In other words, God was able to do something in your life, and you can receive it by faith before it's ever done. You've got to recognize and let your faith interpret your situation. It ain't getting bad, it's getting better. You ain't growing older, you're growing younger. You about to step from time into eternity. You got to let your faith interpret your situation. Listen, Jesus says, if you have faith and never doubt, you can say to this mountain, be taken up and cast in the sea, and it will be done to you. Seniors, I know you got some mountains in your life, but you got to let your faith move the mountain now. You don't have the strength now, but your faith has strength that you don't have now. You got to apply your faith to your situation. Jesus seemed to be saying that there is hardly anything that faith cannot get accomplished. You've got to recognize that God has given you a powerful tool. These youngsters running around here with their hair all black and got their bodies all in shape, but they got to see what you got. And it can't be seen with a natural eye. Baby, you're finer than fine can be if they look at you with a spiritual eye. You've got some spiritual muscles you can flex they don't have. And you've got to let your faith interpret your situation. They look at the sky and say it's going to rain. You look in the sky and you say God is working things out. They look at a situation and say it's going bad. You look at a situation and say God is the author of bad, and he knows how to turn what meant for bad into good. You got to let your faith interpret your situation. You got to recognize that all things work together for good for those that love the Lord and are called according to, listen, to his purpose. You got to let your faith. Listen. Let me just close this feeble thought. Let me tell you this story. Because faith is an emergency switch. Wish I had somebody. You can flip it at any time when seem thing to be beyond your control, when God can step right in and work it out. Ray Stedman was traveling through the state of Oregon. He had a little daughter by the name of Susan. She had to develop a fever that night. They were staying in a hotel. Didn't seem all that serious. As they drove, all of a sudden, she went into a convulsion. Her eyes turned up. Her body began to jerk. Ray slammed on the brakes, clutched his heart, grabbed her, stumbled across the street. There was a farmhouse in a distance about 6 o'clock in the morning. There he came knocking, banging on the door with a thunderous sound. Woman answered the door. He says, "My daughter is very sick. She's in convulsion. Do you have a bathtub so I can run some warm water and put her in it?" Before the lady could ever really say anything, she motioned down the house. Stedman kicked the door open, ran down the house, put his daughter in the bathtub, and began to run water. And later he arranged for the doctor to come see his daughter. Or he arranged rather for the doctor to examine his daughter. But listen, it all turned out after Stedman had went back and examined this situation that his daughter was all right. But later he found out that this was the only farmhouse that had a bathtub and a telephone for miles. You know what I stopped by to tell you? No matter what you're going through, God has set up shop right across from you. I wish I had a witness. A whole lot of us are going through a lot of things, and we thought that God has forgotten us. But I stop by to tell you, God has set up shop right across from your problem. And if you flip that switch of faith, God knows how to work it out. He knows how to step in and rearrange your situation. He set up shop right across from you. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. He set up shop right across from you. And everything that the devil is trying to take away, that life is trying to rob you of, God is trying to give it back. Listen, seniors, he's trying to give it back. Life has robbed us all of some things, but the Lord is trying to give it back. Will you let him? Will you let him give it back? Let him give it back. Say, "Pastor, what is the number one thing that life has robbed me of?" It's robbed you of a relationship with God, because we were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. But God knows how to give back what the devil has stolen. Will you let him? "Pastor, I never had a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, but today I'd like to have one." Will you let him? All you have to do is open up your heart, and you can appropriate what God has for you if you open up your life. That's what faith is. It's a gift from God, but it's a gift that says, "God, I want what you have for me. And I'm going to trust today that you will give it." Because you're not a God that will say something and won't do it. You're a God that keeps all of your promises. "Pastor, I need to accept Christ as my Savior." Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Just this moment, let him have it. Let him have your heart. Let him have your life. If that's you, let me pray for you. Rather, let me pray with you. Say, "Pastor, it's me." Would you just slip up your hand? Every head bowed, every eye closed, just slip up your hand. Just slip up your hand. I see you. I'm going to pray a simple prayer. It says, "Jesus, today I'm yours. I trust you for all of eternity with the safekeeping of my soul." Those of you who get the tape can pray the same prayer. But trust him today. Let's pray. "Jesus, today I'm yours. I trust you for all of eternity with the safekeeping of my soul. Forgive me of all of my sins. Cleanse me. Wash me. Make me whole. I've done things that I regret. Often they're played back in the recesses of my memory. But I trust today that you will forgive me of everything. Today, I receive you as my Savior, as my Lord. Today, I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. Today, I believe that God has raised him from the dead. And based on your most holy word, Romans chapter 10, verse 9, I am saved. Come on, give the Lord a great hand clap of praise. Come on.
Set out on a narrow way many years ago, hoping I would find true love along the broken road. But I got lost a time or two, wiped my brow and kept pushing through. I couldn't see how every sign pointed straight to you. Every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, they were like northern stars, pointing me on my way into your loving arms. This much I know is true, that God blessed the broken road that led me straight to you. Yes, it did. I think about the years I spent just passing through. To have the time I lost and give it back to you. But you just smile and take my hand. You've been there, you understand. It's all part of a grander plan that is coming true. Every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, we're like northern stars, pointing me on my way into your loving arms. This much I know is true, that God blessed the broken road that led me straight to you. Bless the broken road that led me straight to you.